Well, Spencer, we got a few military news stories, just some quick bulletins to go through to keep people up to speed and what's going on in the Pentagon news bulletin. One of those, kind of an interesting story that I just saw, says the U.S. unleashes the military to fight fake news. You know, basically what's happening is the Pentagon is creating a unit where officially the military, members of the military are going to be tasked, people in the Pentagon are going to be tasked with going through like Facebook ads and tweets to determine whether or not they are quote unquote fake news.
I guess what's so frustrating about this story is this whole idea of fake news. I mean, I don't know if people recall, it originally was used by the Democrats against Trump.
Right.
And in typical fashion, you know, being this like, it's almost like the blob, like they threw that at him and he just like completely absorbed it, reassimilated it, and then he wielded it back against it. And now, you know, we're living in this era where, I mean, we have been for a while where the nature of truth and careful argumentation are hardly going to move the needle anymore. But now more than ever, I mean, you see why this claim of fake news was such a specious argument to begin with. I mean, the majority of the news agencies that run the show in this country mm-hmm. are for profit, okay? Yep. And these for profit news networks have, you know, they sold you a war in 2003 with Iraq. Mm-hmm. I mean, and they continue to distort the reality in the present day, the historical reality. So this idea of fake news is always so frustrating because it misses the entire point of how all of these for-profit news channels have an agenda. They have particular figures who are either part of or associated with the capitalist class with whom they're beholden to.
The way that they frame it is it's interference in our democracy, right? And so Russian trolls who are sowing discontent right. and reducing confidence in our system, that's undermining our democracy, right? You know, like MSNBC, CNN, they like went to Florida and confronted Trump supporters on their doorsteps being like, you shared this meme on Facebook that was created by someone in Albania, an Albanian troll who was trying to influence our election. And they're like, what the fuck are you talking about? Like, that didn't make me a Trump supporter. I was already a Trump supporter. I would have shared any meme that came across my Facebook page that was making fun of Hillary Clinton. You know what I mean? So it just like created this kind of weirdly false thing about how our democracy was undermined because there was like a meme of like a swole Bernie Sanders with his shirt off that was supposedly created by Russian trolls that influenced our election somehow. It just like the whole thing is absurd that even influences our election. But the way that it's actually used, right? That's the auspice, right? Is this idea that Trump didn't really win. Russia really made right. Trump win. The American people didn't want Trump to be the president. But the way it's actually used is to take down accounts when there's a political struggle that are against the Pentagon. So it's fitting now that the Pentagon is officially in charge of determining what's fake news or not. So for example, when the coup in Venezuela was taking off, YouTube, Twitter, Facebook just removed hundreds of accounts that were deemed fake news. They weren't fake news. They were pro-government accounts. They even deleted the president of Venezuela's Twitter account, his English account, for being fake news. The same thing's happening with Hong Kong, right? I mean, of course, there's lots of complexities to the Hong Kong protest. It's not a black and white thing. But hundreds of accounts that were pro-Chinese government, of which there's a lot, because I think the Chinese government has something like a 90% favorability rating. There are hundreds of so-called pro-China accounts were deemed fake news and removed from Facebook, Twitter, YouTube, and things like that. So they practically use it as a way, as part of their propaganda operation when they are trying to get some kind of regime change operation or, you know, destabilization efforts and things like that. But again, it also kind of plays into the whole, you know, siphoning of energies against Trump into this belief that Russia stole our election through this fake news operation, right? I mean, this is kind of similar to what happened with Watergate, where under Nixon, you know, there was a massive social movement against Nixon, against the war, all of these things. Mm-hmm. And there was a huge grassroots upswell that was increasingly militant, increasingly successful. And then when Watergate happened, they were able to turn everything into focus everyone on Watergate. Like, here was the transgression. The system can solve it, da-da-da-da. And then they tried to suck up a large sector, the more liberal sector of the social movement, into focusing on Watergate. Same when Trump won the election, I was like, oh, damn, it's going to be like George W. Bush time again. Like, everyone's going to be in the streets. It's going to be a huge, there's such a political crisis for the establishment. But they, and even the Democrats, they wanted to siphon all of that into this, no, it was Russia. This wasn't really the system. And we have to focus on getting Russia out of our politics and things like that. It has this two-pronged thing, right? It allows the U.S. government and the U.S. military to censor people that they say are fake, that conflict with their plans. And then it also says to the social movements and liberal sectors of the social movements, back us in our plan to combat the attack on our democracy. And that's how we're going to get rid of Trump.
I mean, aside from the fact that it just shows the complete abdication of responsibility on the part of the Democratic Party generally and Hillary Clinton specifically, with how they refused to effectively campaign in the states that cost them the election in 2016. I mean, the notion of the news being this authentic journalistic source is also just not entirely historically viable. And I don't mean to downplay the significance of Trump's rhetoric in the present age we live in, but I mean, Edward Bernays, the father of what's called public relations, which is essentially just, you know, a form of manufacturing consent in the public. I mean, he played an instrumental role in the way that that Guatemala was presented to the American public in the early 50s, which, right, of course, led to the 1954 coup d'etat in Guatemala, which, you know, the U.S. And that organization, the Central Intelligence Agency, had a major hand in. So it's very insulting when you read these stories, because it's just, it's not only spitting in the face of, you know, the majority of Americans and, you know, people in the world, but also it completely spits in the face of the historical record and of any factual, reasonable grasp on how, you know, this society actually functions.